It's often called fake pot and often advertised as being legal. It's sold in stores under names like Spice or K2, but it's not marijuana. It's actually a handful of herbs sprayed with chemicals, and teenagers consider it a cheap way to get high without going in search of real marijuana. But it can also be deadly. Chase Burnett was an honor roll student and a high school soccer player in suburban Atlanta, not far from where we are now. He was found dead in his family's hot tub almost a year ago. A package of synthetic pot was found nearby. Chase was just 16 years old, and his parents, David and Yvette Burnett, join me now. First off, thank you so much for coming in to share this story. I know this is a difficult one, and the reason you're here is so that this doesn't happen to other kids. But first off, can you just tell me a little bit about Chase? What was he like?
Chase was a joy to be around. He would walk in a room and you felt like you've always known him. He made everybody feel comfortable. He would walk in and just have an inner light about him, wanting people to know who he was. He was so interested in people. He loved people. He lived life with a zest. He lived every day like it was going to be his last. And he had an inner light about him. People were attracted to that. Older peers, younger children. And we know they had an inner light just because of how he lived and the love he shared with his family and his friends. And because he just had that inner light from God within him.
And I know that he was beloved by his friends and, mm-hmm. and people he went to school with and teachers, and it was something that really devastated people when he passed away last March. Did you have any sense, David? Did you know that he was trying this out, this fake pot? Did you even know what it was?
I was not aware that he was trying it out. I was aware of what it was, but I had no idea that he had experimented with it just a handful of times. We found out the day that he passed away that he had experimented with it just a handful of times.
And that was from his friends?
Yes, I found that out that morning from some of his friends that came over, as well as we had about 10 or so of his friends over a week after he passed away, and I had them all sit down on our couch at our home and asked them to really come clean with what was going on in the community and who was doing it so that we could nurture them and explain to them that obviously bad choices have deadly consequences.
And what did you find out, that a lot of the kids were doing this, that it wasn't just Chase?
There were several doing it in the community. I can say that. It has since curtailed. The activity within the community, within the children, has stopped. However, there's a little bit of a misnomer that Chase drowned in a hot tub.
Sure.
Obviously, we found him in a hot tub, and that was part of the, it was on the autopsy report, his death certificate, but what killed Chase was the synthetic cannabinoid poisoning, the marijuana, the chemicals that were sprayed onto the leaves shut his lungs down. He suffered a violent death. He asphyxiated and suffocated, and he obviously became unconscious, and I found him in the hot tub that Sunday morning, March 4th.
Something that was legal, allegedly, that he had purchased. Did you have a sense, Yvette, after talking to some of his friends, that he had any sense of the dangers of this?
Oh, no. None of the kids did. Especially Chase, he loved life too much. He would have never, ever done anything that would have harmed himself, knowing how much grief it put his family through and his friends through. Never.
They just were being experimental, as some teens are. That's mm-hmm. the impression you got?
Mm-hmm.
How you're here because this has become a mission for you, right? Mm-hmm. To try to make sure that other kids don't follow in Chase's footsteps. Why is this so important to you?
Well, for us, just the heartache, your heart's just ripped in two. We don't want this pain to affect other families. It's a senseless. It's a senseless death. A teenager's walking to a store thinking it's legal, thinking it's not going to hurt them. They purchase something that should never be sold. And we just don't want the pain of what we've gone through to affect other families. We have peace and strength from God, and we have that peace in our hearts, and we have the joy because we do know our son is where he will live forever. But it's just every day it lives with us for the rest of our life that we don't get him back.
What can you say to other parents so that they aren't in your shoes, so that they don't lose a child with so much promise?
Well, that is the reason we're here. The reason from the moment that our son, we knew that he passed away that morning when the paramedics came and covered him up and told us that he had passed away, we had a sense of peace about us. Both of us did, because we know where his soul was, as well as Yvette and I. We know that we'll see him again. We have that heavenly hope. But when they said he was passed, I instinctively told myself, this is wrong, wrong, wrong. You cannot walk into a convenience store in this country as a teenager or a young adult or an adult, purchase a product, obviously, to get high, and then your lungs shut down and you suffocate. It is wrong in a purest form. It's very frustrating as a parent to know that this is being sold throughout the country. It's not only sold in convenience stores. It's sold in head shops, adult novelty shops, and various other avenues to sell the product. But it is a deadly product.
Part of the problem is there's this loophole where it's kind of sold legally. So knowing that, until you can get to the point where it's not sold, what can you tell parents to be? Part of it's awareness, I'm sure, mm-hmm. but also what do they need to talk to their kids about so that they understand the risk? Because you said Chase didn't.
Well, it's talking to your children, your grandchildren, talking to them, saying, have you heard about this stuff? Do you understand? And think about the choices. Get online with them. You know, as parents, as adults, we can understand it, but the kids have to understand it in their hearts that this is wrong. It can kill you. Yes, children think they're invincible. Teenagers think, yes, right, it can't happen to us. It can happen to you. Look at us. We are a normal family who loved our boys dearly. We talked to them about the stuff like this. Our son made a mistake. He made a bad choice, never, ever knowing that this would take his life. So I just ask parents and grandparents, talk about this stuff. Don't shovel it under the rug. If you talk to the kids, make sure the kids talk to each other. Do what's right.
Communicate and have an open line of communication
about
it.
Keep the words out of my mouth. You have to take your head out of the sand. It would be easy to ignore it and just to go away, but we choose not to. We have gone from the first day, the day after our son passed away, we went on all of the local affiliates here in Atlanta and came out and told people what happened. We told them that our son's bought it. We assumed he bought it and found out he did. He smoked it and he passed away. And we feel that what we're trying to do with the education and awareness aspect of our mission, we're doing as much as we possibly can to help other families around the country not have to endure the pain and lose somebody that you love dearly.
And let's hope they don't. David and Yvette, thank you so much for sharing this story. We'll be talking more about this, of course. And obviously, if this can happen to someone like Chase, it can happen to other young people. So we appreciate your being here to talk about it.